Blue Planet is the front of the Irish Examiner sports section this morning. That's the Dublin women's footballers celebrating Cork heartbreak as ladies continue Dublin's football dominance. They also won the over 35s All-Ireland over the course of the weekend. Over 40s, is it over 40s?
Yeah, and I was thinking Stephen Cluxton will be their goalkeeper in 2 years' time. Yeah. They're going to have an amazing over 40s team as well.
It's roll on, roll off. I think he'll probably play midfield.
Yeah, probably will.
If he wants to. As he's like, you know, he'll come off the last Sunday in August or the first Sunday in September, winning his seventh All-Ireland, and then he'll stroll on the pitch and in a row, I mean, obviously. So that's the lead there. And Michael Moynihan's writing about sport and the presidency. I mean, I don't know. Well, we'll get back to that. We can definitely come back to that in the future. Stephen Kelly is writing for The Examiner. A five-win start and still not top. That's Liverpool for you. Body blow, Spike O'Sullivan, when he hit me, that was all she wrote. I don't get it.
When he, like, it was obviously game over when he got that hit to the head. It's obviously what he's trying to say, but the way Spike O'Sullivan has been taken, and kind of there's been such a divergent opinion, certainly in the aftermath on BT/Air Sport on Saturday. Like, David Hayes straight in was like, this is a world class fighter against a domestic class fighter, which I thought was probably fair enough if you looked at the evidence of Saturday night. And then other people are kind of like keen to pile in as well. Other people very keen to stick up for him. But everything I saw on Saturday night, including the likes of Max Kellerman for HBO, very straight up with David Lemieux on Saturday, saying, well, this guy was nowhere near anybody else you've ever fought, sort of thing. And quite pointed, I think. People piled right in on Spike, let's just say, after Saturday night.
Yeah, all right. Well, Triple G and Canelo, that was the other fight. And Canelo obviously wins. There's a bit of controversy about the decision. Canelo wants a third fight, which I think probably on the basis of the
Golovkin
rave
wants
reviews.
A third fight.
No, Canelo's
on they both want a third fight?
Yeah, he's like, well, he seems to be happy enough. Whatever way it works out, nothing bad really ever happens for Triple G, does it? For Canelo.
Well, they both should want a third fight, no?
Yeah.
Like, what do they do? Like, Triple G or Canelo will fight Lemieux early next year. Triple G will find himself a fight. And then the rematch in 12 months' time again. So it's September, September, September.
We'll come back to that a little bit later. Andy Lee is going to join us in studio. But now let's go and speak to Sanita Puspure, one of our gold medalists from the weekend, live on the line from Sofia Airport. Sanita, good morning to you. How are you doing?
Good morning. I'm good. Thank you.
So tell us a little bit about your last 24 hours. At what point during the race did you actually feel like, ooh, I'm going to do this?
Probably somewhere halfway when I still could hold her off and she wasn't gaining anything on me. So I definitely thought I'll have enough to hold her off for another 500 meters. And then I know my last 500 meters would be faster than hers. And yeah, but then I still had to kind of brush those thoughts away and just focus on one stroke at a time, because the conditions are a little bit tricky there, so it's easy enough to kind of miss the stroke or lose the oar and drop your water. So I had to kind of keep the head cool and keep going.
Which you obviously managed pretty well. That's it must be pretty tricky, like, oh, I'm going to win gold here, and actually I'm only going to win it if I manage not to think too much about winning it, and yet I've just thought about it. There's obviously
exactly what happens. You just kind of think about things you shouldn't be thinking, and then you think that you, yeah, it's like catching 22. And it's kind of funny, actually, when you have to look back at it. But yeah, I still managed to kind of just get myself back into the race focus, not to think about the end result that could probably happen, that I can be the world champion in 3 minutes. So I just went back to counting strokes, and that kind of kept me focused. Because we've done it so many times in training, so you kind of, as soon as you start counting, you're like, you're doing something familiar. So that brought me back into the race.
Yeah, anybody who was watching you recently, or anybody who was watching you over the course of last week especially, won't have been surprised whatsoever in the manner with which you dominated there yesterday. Do you feel you're rowing better than you've ever rowed in your life, that you're at the very peak of your form right now?
Definitely, yeah. The training program we're doing is quite intense, and obviously I started fueling properly as well, so I can actually manage the training program. Like, this season, like last year, I missed out on Europeans because I got ill right before we departed for the venue, as this year I only had like a few slight head colds and one small injury, so it's been a great season altogether. So I'm really enjoying to feel so fit that I can actually take on the world champion, you know, ex-world champion now. But it's great. It's a great feeling to be so fit and knowing that you can do more.
Yeah, did you think you would get to this point? I mean, like, if you look at Olympic performances down through the years, like, we haven't really spoken to you too much about that. Like, I presume there was part of you that felt you could always go that extra mile, that you could get to a level where you're contending to be either in the top three in the Olympics or even in the World Championships. And you've achieved that now. Do you think you've justified previous hype about yourself, or perhaps made up for previous performances where you weren't quite at it on the biggest days?
I suppose so, yeah. Although you do take something from, let's say, the fourth place last year, it was disappointing, but at the same time, I went in with a lower expectation. So for me, yeah, it was gutting not to get the medal because I was so near, but at the same time, it was great because I over-exceeded my expectations. And, I mean, you never underestimate how strong those girls are that go out and race. Like, they do so much, like, hard work and perfect preparation. Like, you never know, actually, who can come on top. So for me, this year, the gamble of not racing Europeans paid off because I was bell ball behind Janine in Switzerland in the World Cup 3. And then I could be so far ahead now at the World. So it just shows that we'd made the right decision by not going to Europeans.
It's Ireland's biggest ever team, I think, ever since two championships. So, like, obviously, you always want quality rather than quantity, but even just flying over and the sheer volume of Irish people who were expected to compete must have given you a whole pile of confidence going into these championships.
Yes, definitely. Like, the women's pair of Afric and Emily, like, they started racing the day before me, and we've been pushing each other on in training. Like, they race a pair and I race a single, so we're kind of not far off each other on speed. And so it gave me massive confidence seeing they winning their heat. And, oh, actually, sorry, they came second in the heat. But, like, just seeing them doing so well in the heat and then they won their semi-final, I was so happy for them. I took so much confidence from that because I knew, like, if they can do this, I can definitely perform as well. And that kind of, on the day before the race when you start feeling very nervous, that's something that you can take for as a fact that we are fit because we've done the same training. And the team all together is, there's not just quantity, there's quality as well. Like, I think all the crews have done the best they could, and the team spirit in general was really good this year, and we really enjoyed it.
Sanita, I don't know if you have seen the internet go into meltdown after you got congratulated by the Minister for Sport, and you've got a new name.
I have seen. Well, I was dominant on the water, so I can't complain about that. We had a great laugh out of it anyway. So.
That's good. I can imagine your teammates aren't going to call you Sanita anymore. They're just going to call you Dominant. You know, it's not the worst thing to be called.
Yeah, I was thinking to change my middle name to Dominant now in passport. So.
It'd be a good time It'd definitely be a good time to ask the Minister for Sport for a bit more funding. I'm sure that, you know.
Well, to our Throwing Ireland professionals who are in the office, at the moment I think I'm just going to enjoy the success and focus on 2 weeks ahead of doing nothing.
Yeah, fair enough. And so 2 weeks of doing nothing, what does that actually mean for you? Like, when you say doing nothing, does that mean like a little bit of light rowing, maybe only a couple of hours a day as opposed to the normal amount of time, or do you actually do nothing?
You won't see me near the water for a week at least. I'd say the whole 2 weeks probably, because we've been waiting for this break for quite a while, and you just need to recharge mentally as well. You need to start missing it again, and after the training camp we had, I think we all deserve a good break.
Okay.
Well, and it will be pretty much nothing.
Well, listen, congratulations.
Eating ice cream, that's what it's going to be.
Yeah, enjoy it. Enjoy the ice cream. Thanks a million.
I will.
Dominant Sanita Puspure, thanks very much for joining us. Live on the phone from Sofia, obviously a very crackly line in Bulgaria.
We do need to point out that the email that came in was from ministers, so we can't just blame this all on Shane Ross, of course, Brendan Griffin, who, like, I mean, Sanita trains in Cork, Brendan Griffin's from Kerry, he thought that the person who trains literally over the border's name was Dominant, so let's not just put this all on Shane Ross.
Okay, just quickly through the rest of the newspapers there, we'll come back to that. Crowd pleasers is at the back of the Irish Independent Sports section. They're also on the front of the Irish Independent Sports section. So that's the Dublin women's football team absolutely dominating the front of the sports sections. Likewise, on Sports Monday, it is Carla Rowe scoring Dublin's second goal in the game yesterday in front of an absolutely packed stand. Puspore shows tough streak to win gold. That's Liam Gorman in Bulgaria. And cautious club anticipates problems despite perfect start to season. So Liverpool, their head coach, trying not to get the team carried away. Malky Clerkin saying the Ryder Cup is amazing. And then more on the rowers on the back of that. And then the Racing Post. Centurion Warrior forced into retirement after big race injuries. Really disappointing that two absolute legends, in particular Alpha Centauri. I think Chip Fetlock was the reason that Alpha Centauri has been retired with immediate effect after what happened at Leopardstown on Saturday in the Longines Champions weekend. And then flag flies high in Irish Ledger and Group 1 joy for Whelan as Skidder strikes. A brilliant ride in that race, kind of coming back and just knowing when to go. All those kind of things that you're kind of like, when you see the race the first time, you're like, oh, that horse ran faster than that horse. And then the quality of the analysis shows you the replay and they're like, yeah, just keep an eye on this one. And yeah, so good stuff there.
Back page of the Irish Daily Mail this morning is disgraceful. Weekend of shame in Tyrone as Cavan, the photo follows chaos. It is some advertisement for the GAA, isn't it? It's like, hey kids, you want to go and get beaten to a pulp and have absolutely nothing ever done about it and really see the levels of injustice that can exist in sport? Well, why don't you join your local GAA club and you can feel that injustice meted out week after week after week, particularly during the club season. Sean Cavan there, battered and bruised, and probably one of many, many cases we're just kind of getting the full light of it because Sean Cavan has got a load of followers on Twitter, and he's dead right to point it out. The other story here in the back page of the Irish Daily Mail is O'Neill in the mix for Munster role. Munster Rugby are believed to have had talks with Kildare senior football boss Keane O'Neill about a role at the province, with Jack O'Connor first choice to take over the Lily Whites if the position becomes available. So this would be a physical training role, a performance, an elite performance role. That's the specific role that might be up for grabs here for Keane O'Neill. Might make more sense for him logistically. He's based down in Cork. He works in CIT. He'd obviously leave that role. That would be a full-time role with Munster. I'm sure that's something that very much interests him. Does a Kildare job then interest Jack O'Connor?
We see, during the summer there had been mentioned that he was chatting with Munster and you kind of kept waiting for the shoe to drop. But then it seemed like he'd signed up for another year with Kildare, and but then that whole process, as we see with the Pat Gilroy situation, nothing is certain until everything is certain. And also, like, that is a career move from head of sport in university and obviously doing really well there to one of the few available professional jobs in professional, full-time professional sport in Ireland. Like, we have the four rugby provinces and we have semi-professionalism and some forms of professionalism across the rest of our sports organisation. So if Munster come looking for you, and it's a role like that, and you can kind of get into the entire root and branch of how the kids get trained and how you train the trainers and how the senior team performs, and like they're going really well and rugby's on the up, you know, I'd be sad to see him go from Kildare, because I think longevity and consistency of performance is exactly what the county needs.
Yeah, we don't know the exact specifics of it, but from what I can gather, if I'm in Keane O'Neill's position, I'd be very, very tempted with the role. As you mentioned there, Pat Gilroy is to quit. Dublin hurling boss forced to step down is the headline at the back of the Herald this morning. Blindsided, really, by this news. It's to do with work commitments that we'll see him predominantly based abroad, specifically, says Conor McKeown here, which, to be fair, I think we can all take at face value. He's obviously got a very big job himself, Pat Gilroy. It's something that was kind of behind the reasons why he wasn't involved in the inter-county setup, I think, between the footballers and the hurlers. But obviously something has changed in the last year or so. So after 1 year, Pat Gilroy to step down. You've also got double delight for the Jackies as Dublin make it a men's and women's double in the All-Ireland Football Championships. Back page of the Mirror this morning is I will be fit. Matt confident he'll be ready for crunch ties. That's James McLean talking about the Nations League doubleheader next month. Back page of the Sun then. Tab of the morning to you. Row, row, row your boat. That's Carla Rowe and that's Sanita Puspure getting into two big stories from yesterday's sporting agenda. And ball or nothing. Champions win 3-0 with 28 shots. But furious Pep cancels day off for extra training session. So he's not happy with their 3-0 thumping over Fulham. He's just upset with his players for a performance that wasn't as well-oiled a machine as we previously see. The thing with Manchester City is they were back-tapping in goals on Saturday, which to me suggests that they're back to last season's form. Back page of the Irish Daily Star then this morning is record breakers. deja blue for Deadly Dubs. Got Gilroy steps down as Dubs manager. Sean, it could have been worse. Doherty and Rice in pitch 20. We'll get into those stories a little bit later on. A good day for the Irish yesterday, I want to say, in the Premier League. If Declan Rice decides to play for Ireland again, that is. Speaking of Declan Rice, speaking of West Ham, they lead
the
way.
He's got a passport, right? So he's definitely Irish.
The Daily Telegraph leads with Pellegrini's perfect birthday present, but West Ham captain reveals players held crisis meeting before crucial win. Turns out it wasn't Declan Rice that was the problem. It might have been Jack Wilshere. And finally, back page of The Guardian this morning is just the start. Yates has talent and age to take on Froome. So Simon Yates, the next great British cyclist, he's won the Vuelta a España. So, you know, British cycling is absolutely dominant at the moment. Of course, all those marginal gains, they've wanted it more than everybody. They are the first cyclist in history to diet well. Did you know that? And the first cyclist in history to use marginal gains. So that's why they've had so much success. So maybe we need to start looking at that model. So congratulations, Simon Yates.